जी मेरी बैग का ये दिखा आइए डब्बा ले लिया क्या क्या सर शुरू करें इजाजत है हिमाचल प्रदेश के माननीय राज्यपाल श्री बंडारू दत्तात्रेय जी हमारे आज के मुख्य वक्ता जो कि हमारा रविंद्रनाथ ठाकुर स्मारक व्याख्यान श्रृंखला के मुख्य जो आज के वक्ता हैं श्री राम माधव जी भारतीय उच्च अध्ययन संस्थान की गवर्निंग बॉडी शासकीय निकाय के अध्यक्ष और उपाध्यक्ष प्राचार्य कपूर साहब और गुप्ता साहब हमारे अध्येतागण माननीय अध्येतागण मेरे सारे सहकर्मी और संस्थान के कर्मचारी हमारे पुलिस के भाई बहन प्रेस और भाइयों और बहनों सबको आज के कार्यक्रम में हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूं और बहुत हमें खुशी हो रही है कि हमारे समक्ष गवर्नर साहब मौजूद है। मैं आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूं सर कि आपने अपना कीमती वक्त निकाल के हमें आज सुशोभित किया सर। तो जैसी हमारी परंपरा है हम दीप प्रज्वलन से शुरुआत करेंगे कार्यक्रम का। तो मेरी आपसे विनती है राज्यपाल महोदय जी कि आप तो सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग के साथ लैंप लाइटिंग कर रहे हैं और राम माधव जी आप राजी और हमारे अध्येता को रिप्रेजेंट करती हैं अलका त्यागी जी आप आके दीप प्रज्वलन कीजिए। डॉक्टर अलका त्यागी और मेरे सहकर्मियों की तरफ से मैं आज के सरस्वती वंदना की आयोजक हमारी संगीता जी को रिक्वेस्ट करता हूं आप आइए। और एक बाकी है अभिषेक जी आइए हमारे अफसर हैं हॉर्टिकल्चर के बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। अब हम हमारे मुख्य अतिथि जी का और प्रमुख वक्ता जी का स्वागत करते हैं हिमाचल में जो हमारी प्रथा है उससे और उसके बाद सरस्वती वंदना होगी। और अब मैं आमंत्रित करता हूँ छोटी सी हमारी सरस्वती वंदना हो, नीरज जी जो लाइब्रेरी में है, संगीता जी और प्रमिला जी पब्लिकेशंस में है, और प्रमिला जी एकेडमिक सेक्शन में है, एकेडमिक रिसोर्स सेक्शन में। The Tagore Center for the Study of Culture and Civilization, which is a part of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, was set up following the 150th anniversary celebrations of Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore's birthday in 2010. It took about 2-3 years for the center to come up. It became functional in 2013. And it was in that year that we also instituted this flagship program of ours, which is the Rabindranath Tagore Memorial Lecture.
Our first speaker in this lecture series
was the then President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee.
And
last year's Rabindranath Tagore Memorial Lecture was delivered by our Vice President, Shri M. Venkaya Naiduji.
So in that illustrious tradition,
we are very proud
to welcome
today
Shri Ram Madhav.
I will say a few words about him in a moment.
His topic,
as you all know,
is the ethical foundation
of nationalism.
And we'll come to that also in a moment.
But we all know what an extraordinary person Rabindranath Tagore was.
Apart from being a great poet
who won the Nobel Prize in 1913,
he was a novelist, a short story writer, a dramatist.
He was a singer. He could sing beautifully.
He was a composer also.
He composed thousands of songs.
He was also a very important painter.
Aspect of his life which is not yet fully studied.
In fact, he was the progenitor of Indian modernism,
one of the key progenitors.
And of course, we know of his great contribution to literature,
arts, crafts,
and to the university that he founded,
Vishwabharati
at Shantiniketan,
which has a wonderful motto
where he says,
Yatra Vishwam Bhavati Ekamida.
This is from the Rig Veda.
I think it is 410.1.
And this is a different idea of cosmopolitanism.
I've called it a colorful cosmopolitan.
Not colorless.
Because imperial cosmopolitanism is in some ways
also racist.
That's why I call it colorless.
White cosmopolitanism.
But what Rabindranath Tagore really contributed to was fraternity between people, arts, literature, aesthetics.
So his contribution was quite extraordinary to the making of our nation.
And yet here's the paradox.
The poet who wrote and composed two national essays, Gana Gana Mana, which we will perform at the end of our program,
but also Amar Sonar Bangla of Bangladesh.
But not just that, in fact the national anthem of Sri Lanka
was also, they say, composed by Tagore, first in Bangla, and one of his students studying with him,
then went to Sri Lanka and translated it into Sinhalese.
There are two opinions on it,
but we know the Vishwa Bharati connection.
So the person who wrote the national anthems of these two nations probably inspired a fourth.
Singapore, Manjula Singapura.
They say he was also influenced by Rabindranath Tagore.
It was composed by somebody else.
He was a great critic of nationalism.
This is the paradox about Tagore.
But his critique is almost always misunderstood.
Because it is based on one book he wrote in 1970.
He went on a tour, went to Japan, gave lectures there,
and later in the United States.
And throughout, he was trailed by the British CID.
And therefore he could not openly criticize imperialism.
So he used nationalism as a code word, almost, because I'm going to qualify my remarks for imperialism.
And this E.P. Thompson has said,
but more importantly, Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan wrote a book on Tagore.
In 1980, and he said, and I'm going to quote him.
This is what our founder, Dr. Radhakrishnan, said on the philosophy of Rabindranath Tagore in 1980.
He said imperialism is nothing but selfishness enlarged and nationalized.
It is the outcome of selfish nationalism.
And he talks about the nations of Europe who are so greedy, expansionist.
They take over the rest of the world and they're still not content.
And Radhakrishnan said, there is no end to their ambition.
Now let's look at what Tagore himself said.
He said, when he criticized nationalism, this is what he said.
The nation, with all its paraphernalia, power, and prosperity, flags and pious hymns, blasphemous prayers, in the churches, and the literary mock hunters of its patriotic bragging, cannot hide the fact that the nation is the greatest evil for the nation.
Why? He says imperialism is nothing but an extension of nationalism.
So when we only look at the 1917 lectures of Tagore, we are taking his views a little bit out of context.
What we should do actually is to go back to Swadeshi Samaj.
An essay he wrote in 1904, he was one of the proponents of the Swadeshi movement.
And the partition of Bengal was determined from here.
Lord Curzon gave out the orders in 1905 to partition Bengal.
And there was a huge movement.
A lot of our freedom struggle owes itself to that very decisive moment.
And then that partition was also reversed.
And Savisachi Bhattacharya, who was a fellow, and then I think he was Vice Chancellor of Rabindra Bharati.
He wrote an article in EPW where he defines five phases of Tagore's engagement with nationalism.
So the first phase was conventional nationalism, 1890 to 1904.
Then Swadeshi agitation, 1907 to 1907.
Then disillusionment and criticism of militant nationalism.
So this is the only phase people focus on.
Which is from 1907 to 1916.
And then critique of imperialism, 1917 to 1930.
Because the Great War broke out.
And Thoreau was horrified.
And he saw it
as an extension of imperialism.
Because the imperial powers were struggling for supremacy.
There was Britain and the Allies, and of course there was Germany and then Turkey.
All of them were imperial powers.
And then the final phase,
31 to 41,
reconciliation of antinomies. So what I'm simply saying is that the Tagore's relationship with nationalism was much more complex than people make out. But he was certainly for one or two very important things. He wanted to build society. He had great faith in the power of society to take care of its own needs. And he said, this is how India functions. This was Bharat, not the state, but the people, the Praja.
So that was his one point.
And he said that unlike Western civilization, which was based on state power, Indian notions of the Rashtra were based on society and the ties between people. And ancient India lived in its villages like modern India. I'm quoting from Swadeshi Samaj. And that's where the basic values of Indian culture
were reflected.
Health, food, education, recreation, and creativity were taken care of at the village level.
And
he said community life was the harmonizing of variety and conflict.
And then he says, this is in Bharat Varshe Itihashe Dhara.
And he said something very interesting, which none of my leftist friends quote, so I must quote it. This is what Tagore says. He says, because of this virtue in Bharat, we shall not be frightened considering any society as our opponent. Each fresh conflict will enable us to expand ourselves. The Hindu, the Buddhist, the Muslim, and the Christian will find a meeting point. That meeting point will not be non-Hindu, but very specifically Hindu. However foreign may be her body parts, life and spirit will be Bharat. And if you actually look at his creative works, if you look at Bhora, if you look at Bhorebari, that is the phase when he is very critical of nationalism, and yet he gives you an idea of India as a cultural and civilizational system which can incorporate difference. A plural notion of nationalism based on the dignity of the individual and the creative capacities, which is what society should promote and engender. That was the idea of the nation. So, one of the critics said Tagore was not an anti-nationalist,
nor was he a
conventional nationalist.
He was an alter-nationalist.
He had a different idea of the nation.
So, sir, here in IIAS,
we are also trying to bring home the legacy of Tagore to encourage humanists and social studies,
as well as some studies in sciences
and math and other fields,
in the broadest possible way
and the deepest possible way, so that we can reflect on the questions that confront humankind, not just local questions.
And if you see what Tagore said,
his universalism was very much based on localism. It was a kind of Atmanirbhar Bharat that he was talking about.
Before I conclude my opening remarks, I just wanted to mention two things today.
It's interesting that there's been a new book called The Battle of Belonging by Dr. Shashi Tharoor. I had an opportunity to engage with him and a few other friends in a panel discussion on the book.
And Shashi Tharoor offers his view that Indian nationalism is a civic nationalism.
But I disagree, and I told him also.
A civic nationalism is based on the contract between the citizen and the state. But our nationalism is civilization.
And so, nor are we in the European model of civic nationalism that you saw in France.
Nor are we in the model of the romantic folk or ethnic nationalism that you saw in some other nations,
including Germany, which is based on language, religion, one language, one religion, one culture, one ethnicity.
So that
there's a little anecdote in the book. You know, one Swede is contacting another Swede and says, I'll see you under the clock, you know, in a particular station in Switzerland, in Zurich. They're a part of some international team. So this Swede comes looking for the other Swede. And he doesn't find him and goes back and forth. Because the Swede he's looking for is actually an African from Eritrea
who's taken Swedish nationality
and is fluent in Swedish. So what does it mean to be Swedish, you know, is a question that Fredrik Thurer asked. So in my debate with him, I said, look, we are a civilizational nation. We're neither a civic nation nor a romantic nation. And just today, Ram Madhavji recommended a new book to me, which I have not read, I must confess, by Kenan Malik. So I immediately bought that book and I started reading it. And it's a history of humanity's engagement with ethics. So I'm not going to talk much about it, but there's only one little thing that I wanted to mention about this book. And he says that Leopold Singer's notion of the discursive utilization of Negro African reasoning, this is a quotation from Senghor, was the birth of negritude, okay? And that was the foundation of many third world nationalists. So when I was thinking about meeting today, I thought that even that doesn't fit into it, because our nationalism is also not based on some, like what he said, negritude. Senghor called it negritude, some unique essence. You know, which defines us. But I think it is an inclusive and plural nationalism. And we look forward very much to Ram Madhavji's lecture today. It's very important to us, sir, because last year, my Ramakrishna Memorial Lecture to His Holiness, the 14th Dalai Lama, was actually on universal ethics. And our own founder, Dr. Radhakrishna, has written extensively on ethics. And we have at least 10 publications of our 500 on this topic of ethics. So I was so glad that Ram Madhavji chose this topic, the ethics of nationalism. We look forward to hearing from you. And now I'd like to invite the chairman of our governing body, Professor Kapil Kapoorji, if he can join us by webinar. Can you please connect him? Can you please call him? And can you please also call Professor Chamanlal Guptaji? Is he going to join us? We'll wait for a moment to see. We had sent them the minute-by-minute program as well. And we were hoping that this would join us today. I'm tempted to mention one more thing. Narsingh Sill has written a very interesting critique of Tagore's idea of nationalism, where he says that Tagore's statement, we who are no nation ourselves, is not historically founded, but fundamentally flawed and romantic. And later Partho Chatterjee also said something very interesting. He said that Tagore was not able to, even though he lived into the 40s, conceive of an Indian state, which could be self-governing. I mean, he could not think beyond this idea of a Swadeshi Samaj for a small village-centric society. He was not able to, despite his great erudition, conceive of a grand idea of a modern Indian state with its own government, legislature, elections. And his disillusionment after Swadeshi, which is evident in Ghore Baire. You see that Sandeep, who is the great nationalist, is seen as somebody who is actually tempting Bimola, and it causes a great problem in their home. And it's similarly, you see Noshtoni, you know, that a family is broken because a politician inspires the wife, you know, to join politics, and a lot of disaster happens. It seems that our respected Professor Kapil Kapoorji, the chairman and vice chairman, are unable to join us. So without further ado, may I please request Sri Ramadharji to deliver the 7th Rabindranath Tagore Memorial Lecture. I present to you Sri Ramadharji.
His Excellency,
Governor of
Himachal Pradesh,
Dr. Shri Dattatreyji,
Director of this prestigious institution,
other
senior functionaries, academics,
and dear friends.
I deem it an honor and privilege
to be invited
to deliver this very important annual lecture on the ethical foundations of nationalism.
I was a little intrigued
when
I realized
that there is a mismatch between the event and the topic.
But thankfully,
Professor Paranjap has clarified that although Rabindranath Tagore
is generally
viewed as
opposed to the Western
idea concept of nationalism,
Nevertheless,
he was very much steeped in Indian idea of nationalism.
Nationalism
is the flavor of the season again in the world.
After the Second World War,
There was a general negative perception about the concept of nation, nationality and nationalism.
Liberal constitutionalism
became
the
buzzword in the world,
fashionable
word in the world.
But then
we see the return
of
nationalist sentiment
in country
after country in the world today.
There were reasons for the world rejecting the narrow concept of nationalism
in the mid-last century.
Some of them were enumerated
by Professor Paranjape.
Even a person of the stature of Rabindranath Tagore
had to rise his voice against the European idea of nationalism,
calling it horrible.
Chauvinistic, etc.
It is returning today not because they have found any very solid, benevolent idea of nationalism.
It's returning in country after country,
especially in the
Western Europe
and
generally speaking in the West.
Because of contemporary challenges like
illegal migration,
racial rivalries. And also collapse of the globalist ideas, including globalization, as also ideas like multiculturalism, etc.
They are all paving the way for the return of nationalism.
Countries are turning inwards today.
Pandemic has added an urgency to it.
We must understand
That the idea of nationalism,
for that matter, the whole concept of nation,
it was very new to the West.
Hardly a couple of centuries.
The nation states that came into existence after the era of reformation.
When the European kings and monarchs started distancing themselves from the papal authority,
that is when the birth of nation states took place.
That was when the first discussion about the very structure, identity, and institutionalization of a nation happened.
So the entire history of nation states in the West And by extension, the understanding of nation and nationalism in the West.
It hardly two, three centuries old.
And in this period,
if you look at the history of these so-called nations or nation states, they still have not found a solid ideological foundation. They could not find a proper rhythm even to this day. There is utter definitional confusion as to what constitutes a nation.
I can just give you two examples.
Look at the United Kingdom. UK.
In 1702,
England, Scotland, and Wales came together.
To form what used to be called Great Britain.
They called Great Britain the nation state at that time.
But that was just an arrangement, as Professor Panditpur pointed out, it was a kind of civilian arrangement.
Neither Scots fully agreed with the Brits.
Now with the English.
Not the Wales accepted the English authority.
Scots were Presbyterian. They had their own church.
English had their own Anglican church.
When they separated from the papal authority, they built their own church, which is the Anglican.
Wales had their own Anglican church,
but they could be different from English. They maintained their separate identity.
In 1801, 100 years later, Ireland was occupied.
Great Britain and Ireland came together to form the United Kingdom of Britain and Ireland.
That did not last long.
The Catholic majority in Ireland protested against Anglican control.
Early 90s, Ireland became the Republic of Ireland as a separate country, remaining Northern Ireland, which by then became Anglican majority, remained with Great Britain. That is the United Kingdom we see today.
In a span of 300 years, it took three different forms.
Even today, the Scots are not sure as to whether a part of the nation state of the United Kingdom or not.
They want a referendum. One referendum happened narrowly, unity survived, and another referendum.
Same is the case in American history.
If you read the American history, you come across the same situation.
Until very recently.
In fact, Samuel Huntington,
A very renowned American political scientist. Most people remember him for only one book,
The Clash of Civilizations.
He was much maligned, condemned, criticized for that book.
But the real story about America, Huntington, was a book called Who Are We?
That book came out 10 years after the Clash of Civilizations, in 2003. In Who Are We, the very question that Samuel Huntington was asked was whether America could be regarded as one nation or not. This was almost 176 years after freedom, when they decided America as the United States of America.
In 2003, Huntington raised this question, how we really become one nation?
In fact, I
would like to
quote
what, he wrote in that
Who are we book?
Globalization.
Multiculturalism.
Cosmopolitanism.
Immigration.
Subnationalism.
And anti-nationalism.
All of them had battered
American consciousness.
Ethnic, gender, and
racial identity came to the fore.
In contrast to criticism,
many immigrants were ampersand.
Symbols of
maintaining dual loyalty.
Dual citizenship.
Most of our Indians are dual citizens today.
A massive Hispanic influx raises questions concerning America's linguistic and cultural unity. Corporate executives, professionals, and diplomats, technocrats, cosmopolitans over national identities.
Teaching of national history gave way to the teaching of ethnic and racial history.
The celebration of diversity, deep place, identity, created emphasis on what America has in common.
Last statement is very important. The stars and stripes were at half-mast.
The American national flag.
They were at half-mast. And other flags flew higher on the flag pole of American identity.
This is the nationalism discourse we mostly try to borrow.
They did not have any political clarity.
They were themselves confused.
They created an African continent into some 50 nations.
You know how African nations were created? Berlin Conference. European powers sat together. Kept the map of African in front of them.
What is the territory you are controlling?
Most Westerners understand the Treaty of Westphalia. When they know Protestants and Catholics, after 30 years of bloody war, came to an understanding about how to continue with their respective countries. It was agreed that, you know, the famous statement was that, you know, the road to heaven need not pass through Rome. Meaning, we don't have to be loyal to Catholic Church in order for us to get salvation. That was the essence of the Treaty of Westphalia. After that, there was this whole idea of nations started emerging in the West. No nation, I mean, Michael Hubbard's quote it is, no nation in the true sense of the word could be born without war. 30-year war of Protestants and Catholics was the result of creation of nations there. So his conclusion was, nations were a product of war. No self-conscious community could establish itself as a new and independent actor on the world scene without an armed conflict or the threat of one. Bina jang ke nation bantani. This is the understanding of some people. Some believe that no territorial sovereignty can become a basis of nationhood. But then, philosopher also raised the question, how can territorial sovereignty be considered as the basis for nation? Because his statement was, if Sparta and Rome perished, what state can hope to endure forever? How can you say that territorial sovereignty will build a nation? Sparta could not survive. Rome could not survive. Then came the idea that why not say that culture can make nations? So socio-cultural definition for nationhood was given by people like Michael Seymour, Paranjapeyappa was referred to him. Why I am talking about, at length about this Western understanding and confusion about nationalism was that this is the basis on which we try to understand our own nationalism in India. Based on the Western understanding of nation, which was rejected by people like Rabindranath Tagore, they said, no, this cannot be any basis for India. But in India, the debate started occurring as to whether we were a nation or not. Sir John Strachey said, you are never a nation. You were never a nation. Based on his understanding of nationalism. So his famous quote in 1888 was, this is the first and the most essential thing to learn about India. That there is not and never was an India or any country of idea of India possessing, according to European ideas, any sort of unity, physical, political, social, or religious. No Indian nation. No people of India of which we hear so much. There was no Indian nation. That was his conclusion. So then Anglophiles in India thought, because there was no Indian nation at all, according to the British understanding or the Western understanding, we should start creating one. Surendranath Banerjee authored a book, A Nation in the Making. We have to build a nation in India. Problem was that we were looking at the whole idea of nation, nationalism, etc., from a European prism. From their understanding, we were trying to define ourselves whether we are a nation or not. In fact, Irlal Jain, the most respected senior editor of Times of India and many other journals and papers, used to say that the very word nation itself is very egregious in any ethos. Because the concept of nation was based on the other in Europe. So it doesn't apply to India. It is very, very anti-Indian thinking. Aurobindo. Famously, he also rejected the theory that essential conditions of nationality are, language, religion, geography, race. He pointed out that English nation itself was built on various races. I mentioned to you, various races. Switzerland had distinct nation states. In fact, initially in America, presidents used to take both in 14 languages. Because there were 14 states which got together, they should take both in different languages. Deendayal Upadhyaya tried to highlight this difference between the Western European thinking of nation and nationalism and the very Indian idea of it. For Deendayal, nation was a living organism, not just for Deendayal, for many Indian thinkers, including Ambedkar, including Nehru. But Nehru used to call India a cultural entity. Ambedkar went one step forward and said it's a spiritual entity. Deendayalji used to call it as a living organism. When a human community living in a certain tract of land for centuries starts experiencing a certain identity with it, customizes the special qualities of its life, develops a common set of traditions, a common life's mission, a common history through which its great saints and sages nurture the great civilization through their penance and sacrifice. It is then that a nation with a distinct cultural life is born. Our understanding of nation is different. Deendayal used to refer to Israel. We all know that Israel, as a country, has a history of more than 2,000 years as a nation. But they were thrown out of their motherland, their country, their geographical fatherland. 2000 years ago, they had to live as refugees in a number of countries throughout the world for almost 2000 years. Every year, wherever they are, they used to come together at one place, the Jews, remember their motherland. And at the time of parting, they would shake hands with each other with the slogan that next time in Jerusalem, next year in Jerusalem. 2000 years. You can imagine how many generations must have passed. But every time they remember that we have to get back to our motherland, we have to get back at Jerusalem. Tirthaji raises this question. What was that sentiment that had lived on for centuries, even when there was no country? There was no country. No government of their own. What was that sentiment that had motivated them to return to their fatherland, leaving behind their hard-earned wealth and prosperity? Do you know that when Israel was finally created in 1948, Jews living in different parts of the world, they became the citizens of the country. 10 generations, 15 generations, 20 generations, they have been living there. But suddenly, the moment they found their motherland returning, they left behind everything that they had there, their money, their wealth, their position, their prosperity, returned to Israel. Then they asked this question, what was the sentiment? That is their thought as eternal reality of nation. It's a concept. It's a sentiment. It's not physical. It's emotional. Geography may not be there. Government may not be there. Language may be forgotten. Shimon Peres was one time president of Israel. He authored a beautiful book, No Room for Small Dreams. In that he discusses about the Israeli Jewish history. He writes, the Jewish people have lived by the guiding principle of tikkun olam, the ambition to improve the whole world, not just others. We lived in exile for 2000 years, this Peres writing, without land, without independence, held together not by borders, but by the simple set of values that have echoed through our history, in Hebrew, in Yiddish, in Latin, in English. In every language of every country into which the Jewish people disperse. The moment we go to America, we forget our language, of course. We become more English than English. But we forget everything about us. But here, there is a for 2000 years, whichever language we adopted, in that language, we remembered our values. We did not forget them. And it is from this moral code that we know fundamentally that Israel was not born to rule over other people, that to do so in profound opposition to our heritage. Look at the words, choice of words, set of values, identity, moral code, heritage. These are the things that kept the Israeli Jewish nation alive for 2000 years. That core is what made Jews the nation. You know, K. Raja Rao, the famous great writer, great author, he once made a very interesting quip. He said, it is not the Indian who makes India, but India makes the Indian. What is that India that Raja Rao was talking about? That India is the national consciousness. That India that Rajarao was talking about was actually the soul. In fact, there is a great debate over whether nations have souls. Humans have souls. Do nations have souls? Very interestingly, the first person to raise this debate was Chesterton, the British, famous author. What happened was when he tried to enter America, those days, in the the immigration, he was asked certain questions. The questions were, like, you know, interestingly, are you an anarchist? Are you a polygamist? Do you believe in Bahukarya? So, questions like this were put to him for allowing him to enter. Then he says, what is this? So then he says, America has a different soul. Then he offered a beautiful monologue with the title, that is from where it all started, the famous statement of America, that America is a creed. So he was the first to raise this issue. But before him, Disraeli, another great British politician and statesman, incidentally he was the only Jew to become the Prime Minister of Britain. Disraeli raised this argument that no, nations also have character. Nations also have soul. Nations also have inner character. You know, it is... as a student, I read it that Germans don't laugh. It's not that they don't laugh. But a trait, a character of that particular people is highlighted in the statement, Germans don't laugh, because they are sticklers for order to the point of absurdity. French are typical playboys, always dreaming of violent women. Stereotyping. I mean, when you talk about national character, this is how we try to stereotype them. The Americans are fond of expensive cars. The Russians, uncouth, pugnacious, and reckless. Fond of vodka and street brawls. When we talk about national character, this is what immediately occurs to us. You know, there's a joke. Why psychologists used to oppose this whole concept of national soul, national character, was because of the stereotype. One joke goes something like this. What will different nationalities, people of different nationalities do when they see a fly in their glass of beer? The German, being a practical guy, will remove the fly and drink the beer. The Frenchman, being an idealist, will fish out the fly, wipes it, allows it to fly away, and discard the beer. The Russian will drink the beer along with the fly. While the Americans are conscious of human rights at all that. A conscious guy about his rights, will summon the waiter, scold him to his heart, and demand for another glass of beer. This is considered national character. When we talk about national character, we talk in these terms, in these trivial terms. But friends, national character is not to be seen as a trivial matter. National character, national soul, these are very essential ingredients for any nation to rise, any nation to be formed. Two great philosophers who talked about national soul were, one was Aurobindo, the other was incidentally Hegel. Hegel called it spirit, Aurobindo called it soul. But both talked about a deep sentiment, deep feeling that is essential for the formation of a nation. Dindar Upadhyay used to call it chitti, inner soul. But it's my Siri. Siri, what does the Siri got alerted? Very interesting. Even Nehru, if you recall his speech on the night of 14th of August 1947, the night when we became independent, you know, we hear the famous Swiss Fifth Destiny speech. I just read one sentence of the speech. He says, a moment comes, which comes but rarely in history, when we step out from the old to the new, when an age ends and when the soul of a nation long suppressed by fatalism. Even Nehru, a very modernist, very European in his approach and thinking and all that, he also believed that India is not a nation, it has to be made into a nation. Admit that no, there is something called national soul. That soul has finds its utterance, its expression. Hence, this national soul, a nation formed on the basis of a soul, a national character, is what Indian nation is all about. We did not call it nation. We used a very Indian word, Rashtram. Rashtram is the ethical, spiritual idea of nation of we, the Indians. You know, Professor Thapa was talking about the art of nationalism of Tagore, or Ramarajya of Gandhi. That was the Indian concept of nation. We, first of all, we give certain characteristics to our concept of nationalism. Our nation is feminine. Very interestingly, the entire West called nation as fatherland, masculine. Our attribute to nation was feminine. In fact, in the Pratham Mandala of Rigveda, in the very first Mandala of Rigveda itself, the very first Veda, very first Mandala itself, we declare, through Saint Vak, Vak is a lady saint, female saint. She says, Aham Rashtri Sangami, Vasunam Chikitsushi, Pratama Yagyana, meaning, I am the beholder of this nation, this Rashtra, I am holding this Rashtra, benefactor of the gods, I will be the benefactor of the gods, and first among the worshipped, to be worshipped. First is me. Feminine to be worshipped first. Nation to be worshipped first. This idea was given in the first mandala of Rigveda. We know the whole concept of Bharat Mata is actually a product of this thinking in India that nation's attribute is feminine, not masculine, not aggression, but sublimity. Radhakumar Mukherjee authored that famous book, Fundamental Unity of India, 4 volumes it is. It's a monumental work on Fundamental Unity of India. The foreword of it was written by Ramsay MacDonald. In that foreword, Ramsay MacDonald says a very interesting thing. The Hindu regards India not only as a political unit, naturally the subject of one sovereignty, if you are a political unit, you are sovereign, but as the outward embodiment, as the temple, even as the goddess mother of his spiritual culture. He made India the symbol of his culture. He filled it with the soul in his consciousness. It was his greatest self. Nation in India evolved through penance of Rishi. It did not come out of war. It was not created out of language identity, out of geographical factors. It was a product of the penance of rishis. In fact, the Rigvedic hymn, Bhadram Ichanta Rishayaha, Swarvida, Tapo Diksha Mukusam Naragre, Tato Rashtram Paramojasya Jatam. What it says for that the saints and sages were in deep penance and deep discourse with each other. A benign wish emanated in their heart, a noble wish. The noble wish for the abhyudaya, well-being of the mankind, well-being of the people. That is how nation took its birth. So here, the basis for our nation's birth, our Rashtra's janma, was the benign wish of our sages and saints for abhyudaya, for welfare. That is why the foundations of this nation do not lie in the political governments, do not lie in language. People say the communists propagated for decades on that since India had 16 languages, India is 16 nations. But this Indian nation, the Indian Rashtra was not formed on the basis of any of those things. But it was formed on this benign wish, Bhadra Incha, for Abhyudayam. Abhyudayam means both material Abhyudayam in this world and spiritual Abhyudayam in the afterworld. That as the basis, this nation was created, certain ethical foundations were laid out, were stipulated. And the question of the whole creation, whole universe, the ethical principle was Isha Vasimilam Dharam. The whole world is Isha. You know, I'm not getting into trivia, but this is an important trivia. Still taking time. One day I had an American friend who is a practicing Hindu. I asked him, what attracted you to Hinduism? So he told me that his guru narrated a story. What was the story? One day, one Hindu saint, Hindu sadhu, went to Europe, went to Rome, so he thought he should call on the Pope. He went and called on the Pope. When he was talking to the Pope, he realized that there was a fancy-looking red-colored telephone on the Pope's office table. He asked Pope, what is this? Pope said, it is my heartbeat to God. So the saint was surprised. In India, for you to talk to God, or group, well, you will suffer tapasya. And even then, there is no guarantee that God will come. Even for say, Brahma, Urosi and all that, then he is very merciful, he will come. But here, there is telephone to talk to God. He was not convinced. Then Pope said, no, no, if you are doubtful, just make a doubt. So Swamiji died. Pope came, suddenly God came on the line. For a sadhu, if suddenly God comes on the line, what does he want? So 2 minutes ke, 2 minutes ki baat hogi, are you okay? Khand bahut zyada hai, Parvati ji ko sati to nahi hui. Nandi ji is okay. Idhar udhar ki baat hogi. Then Swamiji put on the phone. Pope said, no, you are convinced. Swamiji said, yes, absolutely. You are religion has no progress. When Swamiji wanted to leave, Pope Sahib gave the bill. For 3 minutes of conversation, it was $3,000. Pope Sahib ko malum nahi tha ki mamla itna gada. Swamiji ko malum nahi tha ki itna mehenga mamla. But having made the call, he came back to India. After a few years, Vajpayee invited Pope Sahib to come to India. Pope Sahib came. Remember ki Madhura mein Swamiji the, milne hai. Why not Kalani? So Pope Sahib went to Kalani Swamiji. Swamiji was in his kuti. Folks have noticed the Lal Rangwali phone on Swamiji's table. Folks have asked, you are private now? Swamiji said, yes, yes, we are private ever since Prabhupada Maharaj became the IT minister. Every house has a phone, every pocket has a mobile phone. So, folks have said, I need it badly. 1 week ho gaya Rome chhodke, so many problems every day they need to consult God. So, I need to talk to God. Folks have, Swamiji said, okay, make a call. So folks have God. God came on the line. Folks have had many problems unlike Swamiji. So he went on talking 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, after 1 hour. After 1 hour, he put on the phone. Swamiji asked, how was the line? Is that clear? Folks have said, very clear. Better than my own connection. I did not realize that your country has progressed so much, so well. So, then while leaving, Pope Sahib asked, okay, tell me what is the bill. So he said, no, no, in India we don't take money from the guests. You are our atithi hai, we don't take charge you. Pope said, no. It's 1 hour call. It must be the expense, please tell me, whatever is the bill I will pay. After that conversation, Swamiji said, all right, you are forcing me so much, so pay me 20 rupees. Pope Sahib is giving discount. Swamiji said, no, Pope Sahib, please remember. In India, making a call to God is a local call. Have I had God everywhere? For you, he is sitting somewhere. Isa Vasimidam Sarvam is that concept. God is everywhere. You go to any remote village in Madhya Pradesh, go to the poorest household, poorest.